Good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, depending on where you're joining us today in the world. I'm Drew Altdoerffer, Product Manager here at Phase 1, and I'm joined by Peter Marshall, Technical Advisor, Technical Supporter. What is your title here at Phase 1?
Technical Support, but I do a lot of other things like everybody in Phase 1.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
never just one job, it's
we
always...
We hold many hats.
Exactly.
Yeah, so welcome to today's webinar. Today, we are going to go over the open platform philosophy of the XF camera system, IQ3, IQ4, the entire product range of Phase 1 that fits this philosophy we have of working with one digital back across all of these components. And the reason you're here, Peter, is because you use all of these cameras extensively.
Indeed.
I think one of the benefits of working at Phase 1, we're a small team, we travel a lot, and your specific benefit of being young, not having a family or children, means that when someone needs to travel, you're the go-to.
Exactly. And the other nice thing about being at Phase 1 is when I travel, I get the world's nicest camera cabinet to go with me.
Yeah, that's true. You're a constant pain in my side just taking all this equipment and moving around the world with it. But the upshot is you are kind of the litmus test for a lot of testing that we do.
Yes.
A lot of ideas that we have, a lot of customer feedback, like customers out there. Your chances are, if you've created a support case, you've probably talked to Peter through that support case. The suggestions you have, sometimes the complaints that you have, sometimes the problems that he solves, you know, those all kind of filter through support, and support is really where we hold the bulk of our knowledge of what's going on out there in the world, what it is we need to improve upon, what it is we need to introduce. And having Peter as one of those people that interfaces with customers, but also travels around the world to all the exotic places and some of the boring ones, camera in hand, you know, he's kind of the one that can test the workflows, test the new features, and really give us a status update of how we're doing. And he's here in the office that we can bounce ideas off of.
Yep.
So we're going to talk mainly about the IQ4 and how the IQ4 kind of fits into all these different camera systems. And really, we're hoping to get your personal view, Peter, of how you use it.
In that case, I'll be very honest.
Okay, well, be careful with that. But yeah, sure. So what we're going to start off with is the Infinity platform in the IQ4.
Yeah.
Right? So the Infinity platform in the IQ4 is really the guts of the IQ4, what it is we've over-engineered. So that this IQ4 can continue to grow and expand.
And I think that's the thing that a lot of people are actually amazed about, is that it looks so similar on the outside, but the inside has in fact been completely ripped out, completely changed.
Right.
And it is although the case might look familiar, you know, I've seen it from day one and the inside is something completely different.
Yeah, it's kind of like an Apple product, you know, an iPhone looks like an iPhone looks like an iPhone, but it's always updated insides, updated screen, updated camera. Our screens pretty much stayed the same, but the insides are completely different. So with the platform that we've built, it's very big, it's very robust. Peter has the inside track of where we're going with this, so I'll remind you to keep that to yourself during a broadcast. You know, we have all these ambitions to grow the camera system. And again, people like you work with Capture One support, you work with the XF camera system, the IQ backs on all these different cameras.
Yep.
So you take all that feedback that people have, you kind of give us a sense of how we can optimize the system, where we can grow it, where we can improve it. And you being at kind of the epicenter of this entire workflow gives us all that insight.
Yeah, and I think it's important that, you know, people who are making these cameras are also actually going out and shooting them and using them. You know, it's not just, you know, sat going, oh, this feature would be great, and then going, but would anybody actually use it?
So right.
Hopefully,
yeah, you're not just an expert in the manual. You're
yeah.
an expert in real world experience.
Exactly.
So with the Infinity platform and that feedback loop that we have, kind of as with people like Peter as a filter, you know, you can take suggestions on someone's Capture One workflow. They might be using a Sony or a Nikon, or a Canon, or a Fuji, or any of these other camera systems, God forbid. But they might have a fantastic workflow suggestion or request that in Capture One that would require the cameras to change fundamentally.
Yeah.
But it's those ideas that you get to bring to us because we have the power to change the stuff in the camera.
And because we have the workflow from start to end, from capturing the image to outputting your final image, you know, we can integrate whatever we like here from start to end to make it work as well as we can.
We just run out of time. I think that's the we have plenty
lots
of ideas.
yeah,
just not the time to do it. So, you know, that system with the XF camera at the kind of the epicenter of that, we also kind of have this other frame of mind, which you, again, are kind of a perfect example of.
Yeah.
Because the XF camera system isn't always used. The whole idea of a digital back is that it is, you know, completely modular. So this IQ4 can go on any one of these camera systems, depending on what the discipline is, depending on what it is you need it to do. And it's really our job to make sure that this IQ4 on any of these camera systems can take advantage of the actual camera, the optics, you know, what it has to offer, and do that intelligently.
Yeah.
So we have very high ambitions for where the digital backs, the IQ4, will go in terms of integrating with technical camera solutions or even custom-made camera solutions. You could have a pinhole camera.
Even more so with the electronic shutter, you can pretty much attach it to anything and
get
a capture.
So, you know, that open platform philosophy, the infinity platform of the IQ4s, really doesn't just apply to the XF. We have some more freedom and flexibility with the XF, but it applies to all these camera systems. So, Peter, you primarily use this Alpha TC.
Yep.
So that's kind of your go-to. And why is it that that is the one that you're using as opposed to this Cambo studio camera?
I think, well, as you said, summed it up there, you know, the Cambo studio camera, I'm often traveling.
Mm-hmm.
I'm often traveling light for a few days, and having the Alpha TC with me, you know, travel compact. It is very small, it is very light. And also, I think the way the camera looks, a lot of places where you aren't necessarily allowed to take cameras, you know, if you show up with this, they kind of look at it. It doesn't look like a conventional
right.
camera. You can get in and still use the great image quality, and you know, it gets ignored a lot. So not only is it small and light, the lenses are obviously fantastic lenses.
Yeah.
But again, you can get into a lot of places with it that maybe aren't too keen on you showing up with something that looks like, you know, a big professional camera.
System. Yeah. This one's more of a question mark.
Yeah.
That one's more of a certainty.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously this is still a very professional high-end camera, but
right.
to the unknown eye, it's not looking like it, so you can
sneak it
into those places and get the photos that other people might
not. It could just look like a technical measurement tool.
Exactly.
Like you're a casual worker that's just surveying the property or something.
Exactly.
This camera system, you know, you typically, your workflow with this camera system, if we back up to the IQ3,
yeah.
that has always been based on LCCs.
Of course.
And can you explain a little bit about that LCC and what your workflow is with those?
Yes. So usually with the LCC workflow with IQ3, as I said, we have a set of A-series backs that have those LCCs programmed in.
Right.
However,
only on certain lenses.
Yeah. Only on the supported lenses that we have there. And when I travel, I don't always get access to those backs. It's often, you know, oh, I've got this spare, you can travel with this. So what I would usually do is take my shot, and then I'd have to shoot an individual LCC for pretty much every single frame.
And the LCC is a lens cast calibration. And it's just that white piece of plexi you put in front of the lens,
yep.
Open up two stops in your shutter speed,
and then take a
second
shot.
A neutral, boring shot. As your basis of measure.
Yeah, and again, for me, that was quite tedious to start with. I shoot a lot of long exposures. You know, if you're shooting a couple of minutes, then you open up two stops, you
right.
know, you're going to be stood around for a long time, not only doing that, but also with your black frame as well. You're going to be waiting double that length of time. So, yeah, moving across the 150, getting to shoot with that.
Right.
Honestly, I took it to Patagonia and shot a bunch of landscapes, and I came back and I didn't shoot one LCC. I'm not saying that's correct.
We were all disappointed in not getting that data.
Yeah, I'm really sorry about that. But I'm not saying that that's the correct way to do it, but looking at these images and downloading them onto the computer, onto my laptop when I had time, I was looking at them and the need for LCC has dropped so dramatically with the 150.
With the backside illuminated sensor.
Exactly. Right. So you're still getting maybe a vignetting or, you know, some color cast, but it's a whole different... A whole different game compared to the IQ3.
And I think that's part of the whole thought process with the IQ4. You know, as Peter mentioned, we have the IQ3 series that has there's an A-series specific build of the digital back, which we custom calibrate to the Alpha TC and the Rodenstock lens, the 23, the 35, and the 70. But that is a very unique bundled product. And with the IQ4, we need more of that flexibility because, you know, we can build a bespoke IQ4 for each one of these systems for each individual lens, but that, of course, just grows and grows and grows, and the overhead of that becomes prohibitive. But because we have the BSI sensor, because we have the Infinity platform in the IQ4, all of a sudden that need for LCCs, as you pointed out, is very minimal.
Yeah.
Now, of course, you still should have made an LCC.
Of course.
But we know that there's ways that we can get around it. So I think part of the ambition when we look at this Infinity platform and where we want to bring the tighter integration of the IQ4 with all these different camera systems is to really mitigate the need for that LCC, that lens cast calibration, which turns into a lens cast correction in the software. Really reduce the need for that. And I think we've got a lot of clever ideas of how to do that.
And I think that'd be every technical camera photographer's dream is to go out, not have to think about LCCs,
right.
Not take the plate with you, not have to hold it up and wait for 10 minutes if you're shooting long exposure.
Right.
You know, it is a, you know, obviously it's a process which is needed, but if we can get rid of it and find a clever, better way to do it, of course, everybody's going to fall in love
with
that instantly.
We've got plenty of clever people here.
Yeah.
Now, no word on when that will happen, but the possibility now is within the Infinity platform because, again, we have this kind of closed-loop workflow. We have the Infinity platform, the 150 BSI. We know a lot about the technical cameras themselves, a lot about the optics, and then, of course, we have Capture One to kind of compile all that data. And then we can go and look into some other ways that we can improve it. These cameras are analog cameras. They are not digitally integrated.
Yeah.
So there is no communication between the camera and the IQ4. So metadata becomes problematic. It's something that, you know, maybe when you were in Patagonia or Antarctica, you were out there with a piece of paper.
And trying to remember which lenses I'd
shot
with.
Which lens with aperture. If you had something like a WRS, maybe you would be noting what movements you had. And all these things are metadata information that can be plugged into the software. But of course, you need a place to record that.
Yeah.
So again, you know, improving that open platform philosophy in the IQ4 is really tying that metadata integration into the IQ4. So you have a place to put all that. And that's of course, something that we're looking into. And I'm not going to make you any promises on when we can do that for you, Peter. But
it would be a little bit nicer than a notepad and a piece of paper.
Yeah, a notepad and a pen, for sure. But, you know, it's part of Peter's experience in that workflow and knowing the pain points of being out in the field and having to do all this stuff,
yep.
Being methodical. Maybe that's not your expertise, seeing how you forgot to do the LCCs. But, you know, he understands the workflow, so he's a perfect example for us to bounce these ideas off of as we grow and expand the IQ4. Then, of course, the last one I put on here is operational persistency. I think there's when you're on an integrated system like the XF, the camera system can be intelligent and kind of remember where you left off, right? It can remember what settings you had. It just shuts down and starts up with how you had the settings.
Yeah.
When you're on a non-integrated camera system, you know, that's up to you. You have to manually go in and reset all those things.
Yeah, and if you're trying to shoot for consistency or anything else, you know, every single time, if you, you know, change out batteries or anything like this, obviously,
you kind of got to start from scratch.
Yeah.
And if you don't have that notepad and pen,
you don't want to be making mistakes when you need to.
So, you know, that's another area that we can, of course, improve upon to really expand this open platform philosophy and really tighten the integration. That's a lot of burden we have to put on the IQ4 for technical camera users, but these are all things that are within the realm of possibilities. And, of course, all the ideas that we have on the table of where we want to take this.
I'm excited to see what happens.
So that kind of that workflow, all of those pain points, you know, the very differing workflows between using an XF, where everything's kind of taken care of, and you can really put that camera system into a mode where it just does all the thinking for you, if you were so inclined. I know you're not. neither am I. But, you know, that possibility is there in an integrated camera system. But the open platform philosophy, making sure that we can make the IQ4 as strong as possible when it's applied to any of these other camera systems. And, you know, that open platform philosophy doesn't just extend to what cameras it can mount on. We make the IQ4 in a phase mount or a Mamiya mount or an XF mount, depending on which camera system you're trying to apply to. But those are the names for the same make and model of that mount.
Yep.
You know, that does limit us to integrating with other camera systems like the Hasselblad V, the Hasselblad H, the old Hi 6, if you remember that one. That might have been before.
Maybe a little before my time.
Yeah, maybe. But it does limit us in terms of integrating to those integrated solutions, being compatible with those integrated solutions. But the optics of those cameras are really the ones that that really keeps that workflow alive.
Yeah.
So the optics from a Hasselblad V, from a Hasselblad H, those can go on an ALPA or a Cambo solution. An ALPA FPS, which is an integrated solution.
And it's always people who are hesitant to change their full lens collection. If you've got a lens collection built up over years and years, it can be an expensive process to change.
Yeah, for sure.
So starting with the back and still being able to use your old optics is obviously going to make it a lot easier for people to experience this as well.
And, you know, just replacing a camera body, the go-between between the optics and the digital back, but maintaining the same digital back, maintaining the same workflow in Capture One, maintaining the same image quality, I mean, that's a fundamental core of where that open flat open platform philosophy, it's a mouthful, comes from. So when we really think about these things, we have, of course, the wonderful Peter Marshall here to use the Alpa TC, and he gives us a lot of feedback on that. We have a lot of other users on Cambo solutions, on Arca solutions, and these are the main ones that we think about. But the integration of the optics, you know, Cambo and Alpa, they take care of the integration of Hasselblad V optics, Hasselblad H optics. So really, we just need to do a little work in the software to give you the right lens profiles and then make sure that the IQ4 is optimized to take care of those camera systems workflows. And when we talk about integration, we have three options, right? So I'm showing you two options. We have cabling options.
Yep.
These are with the IQ3, not the IQ4, but the principle is the same. We have the digital back connected with a adapter that goes from the multi-pin to a mini jack. And this facilitates a little button to wake up the camera system, and then you can plunge the shutter to capture.
Yep.
Then we have one that is just a straight integration. This is something that Alpa does very well with their unique cabling solution, where it's just really one button push will then capture the image, depending on how the digital back is set up. And then your preferred method, because you like to go sans cable when you're traveling.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I think I often just usually forget the cable
right.
as I'm packing differently.
You're really painting a great picture for our support team here.
No, I think it's just because, unlike all other photographers out there, when I travel, it's a case of this is what's available, and I pack differently every time. Obviously,
right.
If I had a constant system that I could hold on to, hint.
You're not getting that.
Have the cable and everything, but again, the electronic shutter allows you to shoot without a cable.
Right.
And again, the improvement between, I remember when the electronic shutter came first to IQ3, I was like, this would be great if we could, maybe push that for handheld and other bits and pieces. And,
right.
IQ4, the electronic scan is a lot faster.
Right.
And, I took some pictures handheld with the IQ4 at the top of a tower the other day on the electronic shutter.
What were you doing on top of a tower, just hanging out?
Just hanging out. Climbing 400 steps for fun.
You go to the craziest places.
And I took some handheld shots on the IQ4 with the electronic shutter. I showed them to our office, had them look at them, and, we couldn't see, some of the waves that you might have seen in the old one. Again, obviously, it's so much better to use on a tripod, but if you are in, situations with high wind or anything else like this, which I experienced a lot while I was away,
mm-hmm.
the performance difference, that quicker scan really does make a difference.
Right, and so the electronic shutter that Peter's talking about is where the actual exposure shutter speed is controlled entirely by the digital back. With all of these solutions, there's a Copal shutter, which is a mechanical shutter that's on all these lenses. So you can select your shutter speed, select your aperture, but with the electronic shutter of the IQ3-100, the IQ3-100 trichromatic, and now with the IQ4-150, the IQ4-150 achromatic, and the IQ4-100 trichromatic, that feature allows you to tell the digital back what shutter speed you want to shoot. You would set your aperture with the Copal shutter on the actual camera, but then your shutter speed, you would just keep the shutter open. Choose your shutter speed on the digital back. There's a capture button on the back there. So then you can just capture.
And the back essentially makes a scan, and that's your image.
Right. True to the shutter speed that you've chosen.
Yep.
And there you go.
And this again, really helped with my workflow, even more so on IQ4, as I don't have to guess the shutter speed anymore. The live view does actually simulate exactly what I have in there.
Right.
So if I am pressed for time or pressed for anything else, I can set up very, very quickly, open the live view, see exactly the exposure I'm going to have,
mm-hmm.
and then go and take the picture and know that I'm going to get the right result.
So in your use with the IQ4s or the IQ3s, you were using the electronic shutter, and providing all these different options, part of the Infinity platform's ambition is that we can start to optimize all these different options depending on what the photographers need. And the electronic shutter is not good for every application. It might be a 1/25th of a second shutter speed, but really it's going to take about a second to scan from top to bottom of the sensor. At 151 megs of resolution, if there's any movement within that 1 second, you're going to be able to see it. Now, you get lucky sometimes because you have really steady hands, unlike
yep.
me. But, that application, of course, can work for some situations. For fast-moving things, like a race car moving across the screen, it wouldn't work.
Yeah, and I think that's, although the electronic shutter might not be perfect for every situation, if you're doing, say, long exposures at night, you're going to get less vibration from the electronic shutter. But I think about, it gives a lot of different options depending. You know, if you are shooting something fast like the race car, you can use the Copal shutter and mm-hmm. connect it. If you're doing something, if you're shooting with a lens that doesn't have a shutter in it, you know, you can use the electronic shutter on the back. So being able to open up all the different methods and all the different possibilities to all these cameras, whether it be using a Copal shutter, whether it be, you know, using the electronic shutter, it's just giving photographers the possibility to use whatever method suits their workflow best.
Yeah, and I think the open platform philosophy is all about options.
Yeah.
You know, we of course, we're not the biggest company in the world.
Nope.
We can't provide a solution for everybody, but if we open up to possibilities of using the digital back on all these different solutions, if we provide different options for cabling and integration, then the perfect solution for a specific photographer will be out there. And that's the whole concept of that open platform philosophy, is whatever it is you need, we can find a way to make it work.
And we want people to use this digital back on as many things as possible, you know, so they get the consistency of the sensor, they get the same image quality from each camera that they're using.
And the workflow in Capture One, it stays the same. You're not moving from one camera system to another camera system. It's essentially, if it's based around this, it's the same camera system.
Exactly.
Just different workflow tools. And that, of course, you know, being able to put this digital back on all these different cameras brings you a lot of possibilities with these, I won't say antiquated technologies, because they're not, they're very modern designs, but they fundamentally haven't changed. They're not digitally integrated, they're not electronic, they're very simple, they're very pure. But an IQ4, simply updating to an IQ4 and putting it on this camera system, opens up the possibilities of each of these camera systems. It gives you access to the Infinity platform and all of its possibilities, all of its processing power, the BSI sensor and all of its image quality, as long as your lenses are up to the task, which 99.9% of these cameras are.
And even so, I mean, you know, you say if the lenses are up to it, but with the BSI, again, we're actually starting to see some of the older lenses that you couldn't use because
of
the
front side illuminated
yeah,
sensor.
Yeah, because of the color cast and everything else you would get.
Right.
You know, there are some lenses now that, you know, I would try and avoid using with the IQ3 with, like, the older style lenses, the ones that haven't been updated in this way.
Right, we won't name names.
And, no, of course not. but again, having this new BSI sensor, it gets rid of that color cast, they become usable again. So you'd be surprised the lenses that you can actually use with this and still get good results.
And, you know, just bringing the making sure these camera systems are brought up to the 21st century, the network compatibility, the power management that we have for this, you know, you in Antarctica and Patagonia, you don't want to be carrying a backpack full of batteries, you want to be carrying one power bank.
Exactly, and especially with more and more, you know, when you're flying, they're really crunching down on the amount of batteries you can fly with. And if you're somewhere without, you know, power source or anything like this, you know, you can't plug in your charger and charge a bunch of batteries. So if you have a power bank or solar solutions or anything like this, being able to charge the battery while it's inside the camera just with a power pack or something like that, it really extends where you can go and use it and how long you can go to these places and still be able to recharge your kit and use it.
And it just makes sure that, you know, these camera systems, which people invest a lot of money in, and they're beautiful camera systems, just have a much, much longer life just by ensuring that this piece of hardware can integrate with those camera systems. And then we can start looking at kind of the future of the IQ4. And I think the FPGA is kind of a big part of, you know, what we always talk about with the Infinity platform. That FPGA is really Phase One's unique twist on how we're reading the data, how we're processing the data. So as we make improvements to the IQ4 and the Infinity platform by altering that FPGA, we can do things that will really expand kind of the image quality, the use cases, the, you know, dynamic workflows of all these camera systems.
And I think even since it's, you know, even since the idea of this came along, you know, there's been things that we've spoken about, ideas that we've come up with, and we, you know, originally didn't have that plan. Or didn't have the, you know, when this was first developed, I used to come to you and say, oh, can it do this? And the answer would always be, you know, well, we haven't thought of that, but of course it can do this.
Right.
You know, the features,
maybe,
like the features that we can add in, the possibility for it to grow is bigger than anything we've had before.
I think for you personally, one application that you use quite a bit is time-lapse.
Yeah.
And time-lapse is something that the XF camera system controls by itself. It has nothing to do with the digital back. The XF camera system is doing the thinking. But when we start looking at the Infinity platform and what's possible with just the digital back, it's of course possible to make time lapse a part of just the digital back. So that means these camera systems can now turn into time lapse cameras.
Yeah, and you can have a lot more possibilities. You know, if you're doing time lapse, you can then, you know, start moving the tilt and shift, which are things that, you know, you might be limited to one lens or something like that on the XF camera.
So I think, you know, that open platform philosophy, it extends tremendously into all these different fringe applications. It really helps to elevate the mainstream applications. Architecture is one that comes to mind. Landscape photography is one that comes to mind. But you know, having that philosophy as a core, having good people that work at Phase One like Peter that really use the camera systems in all these different ways, we can really start to think about how we can optimize the workflow of this entire camera system by just updating this one component. And with the IQ4, really the sky's the limit.
I'm excited.
One part, I can really tell. One part of that improvement is Capture One Inside.
Yeah.
And Capture One Inside, as of today, is pretty much in its infancy. It's taking core elements of Capture One and putting them into the digital back. So that you can actually get a sense for what your final image is going to look like when you're, you know, out in the field just using this small screen. So I think Capture One Inside has huge ramifications for where it's going to go, but where it is now is just taking some fundamental aspects of Capture One editing, putting them into the IQ4, processing some JPEGs that you can store on your SD card. but one of the main ones for you, I would expect is very important, is kind of the WYSIWYG that the Capture One Inside gives you.
Yeah, and I think, you know, this is kind of the thing with any camera system, not medium format, but any camera system is, you know, you go out, if you get up early, if you go to a location and you take that image, you know, there's nothing worse than getting back and downloading it and seeing something entirely different to what you shot.
Right.
Especially if you've, you know, paid for that helicopter flight or you've gone to, you know, somewhere else, you don't want to get back and be like, oh, it's actually two stops underexposed on the computer compared to the back.
Right.
So having a preview that you can look at and be like...
And trust.
Yeah, and look at it and go, I got the shot, this is it, I'm done.
Yep.
You know, and again, I had a lot of this where I would set up, I'd be on a time limit, and, you know, again, I can open up, I can take the shot, take one single image, look at the back, and know that I've got it, and move on, you know.
And I think if you are conceptualizing an image, like maybe you were in Antarctica as a black and white,
yeah,
you're of course not out there in the field with your laptop, so you can edit it in Capture One to make a black and white. You know, this is a very professional camera system, so it doesn't have, you know, all the modes that you might find on a point-and-shoot camera. But Capture One Inside kind of fills that gap, because you can turn on one of the IQ styles for black and white.
Exactly.
You can take the shot, you can evaluate your raw histogram, you can evaluate the RGB histogram, and you can know in that moment that, yes, I've got all the information I need, it is sharp, it looks good, this composition looks good in black and white, and then move on without having the whole process of editing. So, again, the ramifications for that Capture One Inside on the Infinity platform, when we consider the open platform philosophy, it's really giving you kind of peace of mind when using all these other camera systems.
Yeah.
And that goes back to what you talked about with the lenses and the LCCs. If you used a front-side illuminated sensor, you would get all this lens cast and you would hope, I can get that out in the edit.
Yeah.
But with the BSI, because it's so clean, you can take the shot, you might see a tiny bit of lens cast, but you're really going to see pretty much one-to-one of what you're going to get.
Yeah, knowing that it's accurate and knowing it's the same thing is, you know, it calms my nerves a lot when I'm out and, you know, especially these places that you may not ever go back to again, or if you're shooting something that is once in a, you know, once in a lifetime.
Right. And it all just goes back to making sure that workflow is the same no matter what camera system you're going to be using. If it's the XF or any of these great camera systems, making sure that your workflow is the same. You can be spontaneous and creative using Capture One Inside. You can have the WYSIWYG effect of what you see is what you get. And you can maintain that workflow. Now that brings us to the BSI sensor. Even though we've touched on that a little bit, we can just kind of go over it again.
Yeah.
And I'd like you to go over it from your perspective, really, because you've been working at Phase One for quite a few years now.
Yeah.
And so you've kind of seen our progression of image quality when it comes from the first CMOS sensor, the 14-bit 50 megapixel. And then the latest generation of CCDs, the IQ, it was in the IQ280, no, IQ380, and the IQ260 and 360. So just give us your impressions of where this BSI sensor kind of gives you in terms of, I won't put words in your mouth, but a leap of image quality and workflow streamlining.
Yeah, and I think it, if anything, it surprised me, you know. I looked at the tripod.
I told you about it. But I guess seeing the results and hearing it from me are two different things.
I think as well, you know, hearing, oh, it's a 150, and, you know, I'd been shooting a lot with the 100. I've been shooting a lot with the 100 trichromatic.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I was like, okay, this is the 100. It's a flat 100, if you like.
Right.
And then I shot with it, and the files out of the back to start with are the best ones that I've worked with. Not just because, you know, oh, it's the newest, it's this, it's that, it's the highest resolution, but with the technology change that BSI has bought, you know, you are seeing so much less noise, you are seeing, you know, so much better color straight out of camera.
Right.
And the files, as they come in, you know, they're looking like I've already done work with them. You know,
right.
The color rendition out of this back, I would personally say, is better than the trichromatic.
Well, you'd be wrong on a technical level, but in a use case,
yeah.
I mean, just that leap of the BSI sensor.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so much more than just a different sensor design that gives you better noise handling, gives you less LCC interruption. I mean, across the board, that BSI sensor gives you fantastic colors.
Yeah.
On a technical level, if we wanted to really break it down, the trichromatic still edges it out, but for your use case, which is mostly landscape, cityscape,
yeah,
a little bit of architecture in there every now and then.
Yeah, and I think as well with the amount that I'm pushing these files as well, you know, whether that comes within the file handling, but I think it's, again, it's that combination of the sensor, the file handling, Capture One, and it's that fully integrated workflow
yeah.
which is able to give me the best. If I am shooting cityscapes, of course I'm going to have things that are, you know, darker or lighter, and I can pull and push these and really bring out the best that this sensor can produce.
Yeah. And this is one of your fantastic images from Patagonia.
Yep.
Of course, this on the screen for the viewers doesn't do it justice.
No.
But is it on your website? Do you want to plug your Instagram or your website now?
I can plug both of those, or I'll just plug my Instagram. It's PeterMarshall1. And if you like cameras and landscapes and food, there we are.
Who doesn't love those things? Now, going back to what you said about the difference in image quality when it comes to the dynamic range,
because yeah.
bringing up all those shadows is really what we're talking about. We're talking about that dynamic range.
Yeah.
The IQ4 150 in a standard shot has 14 and a half stops of dynamic range.
Yeah.
And that is half a stop less than the IQ3 100 and IQ3 100 trichromatic.
Yeah.
But then we have, because of the Infinity platform, because we have different ways of reading off all this data, we have the extended mode, which
yeah.
is like a low noise mode, which gives us 15 stops of dynamic range.
Yeah.
So you sacrifice a little bit of the recycle time on any of these cameras. I don't think that hinders anybody.
No.
You can speak to
and
the...
Yeah, again, I think it's about options. You know, 14 and a half stops is still a huge amount of dynamic range.
Yeah.
And if you want a faster recycle time, you're probably shooting studio, you're probably shooting something where you don't need 50.
You're in a controlled lighting environment, more likely.
Yeah, and more likely you're not going to miss half a stop.
Right.
Whereas if you are shooting landscapes, if you are shooting, you know, things where you really do need to push this dynamic range and get as much data as possible,
yep.
you know, it's not exactly like, you know, the low noise mode is going to take, you know, 10 seconds or something like that. We say it takes longer to recycle.
Yep.
You know, it's minimal. Even this time is still...
It's about one frame a second is
yeah.
what you're limited to with that.
Which is
on any of these cameras,
yeah,
you'd be hard-pressed to cycle the camera in a second.
Yeah. And again, I think, you know, we're comparing this back to, because we have such a better recycle speed with the IQ4, you know, with the IQ3, we were around, you know,
1.3
yeah.
seconds,
so, 1.3
frames per second.
Yeah, so. Exactly. So you're pretty much the same standard as that, but with 15 stops as well.
And I think the low noise handling, the improved ISO sensitivity, with that dynamic range, that means that dynamic range, on paper, it might be 14 and a half stops, but in real world applications, it's actually more usable
yeah.
than a previous generation that had 15 stops because it had higher noise. So yes, you could pull out the detail, but you pulled out all this noise
with it.
Yeah. And so now you have perhaps less dynamic range at 14 and a half stops, but when you pull up that shadow, the noise isn't there to pull up with it.
I think the amount that you can get out of the files from this, you know, as we said, I think that does surpass anything that we've had before.
Yeah.
You know, it is just a combination of the sensor, of the noise, the stuff that we can pull out of this in Capture One as well. And I think all of that combined, although on paper it says 14 and a half stops, you know, you can use all of these tools together to get, you know, all the shadows and all the details that you need in
yeah. And then that brings us to, you know, back to the Infinity platform and really expanding that dynamic range, because as always, we have great ideas here at Phase One. We have great, very smart people here. So expanding that dynamic range is certainly something that we are working on to do with this camera system. And it's the same camera system that you would buy today, but, you know, down the road, we're going to be able to really utilize more dynamic range, make sure that when you pull up those shadows, you're pulling it up with even more detail and cleanliness, so that dynamic range becomes much more usable and strong. And we touched basically on all these things, but the color performance, against the trichromatic. On a technical level, the trichromatic is better at a fundamental hardware level, at the raw level, that color fidelity is better than the IQ4 150.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to real-world usability, there's very few applications when you would ever be wanting for anything. You know, we went over this with Nils a little while ago, and you know, if Nils is happy with the color response, then we should all be happy with the color response.
I think if you're looking at numbers on pieces of paper, you know, as you said, trichromatic is going to do it. I think if you're using it in pretty much any situation, you know, you are, you know, going to be very hard pressed to.
And I think the more kind of pure way to look at this is because the information that's coming out of the 150 is so much better that when you're doing those edits in Capture One, you're not going to find the breaking point of those colors.
Yeah.
You know, because the quality is so much better, when you want to push around the colors and do some heavy editing, you're never going to find that that point of degradation like you might with older camera systems.
Exactly.
Now, we'll just touch upon this because this just kind of goes back to the use case. When we think about open platform and using this camera system on all this digital back on all these camera systems, and we just think about updating your workflow. If we update this, then we update your workflow with all these camera systems. And so that kind of comes back to the SD card that's in there,
yep.
Updating the XQD so you can store more files, you can capture them faster, you have faster browsing, have more secure data. And then, of course, integrating these camera systems with Capture One in a studio environment, which would, you know, more apply to this than the other ones. But, you know, just bringing this camera system up to a higher speed where it can integrate better, it can power itself from your computer, you have a bit more control over it. Again, once we update the digital back, we basically update this entire camera system and open up the opportunities for any niche workflow.
I think as well, just touching on that as well, I'm sure people will know from things like XF, you know, we do try and make it last as long as possible. You know, we know it's a big step going for this sort of thing, but we like to add updates when we come up with ideas or improvements or anything mm-hmm. like this. We want to design something that is as future-proof as possible. So again, you still get more and more as the technology comes along.
Yeah.
You know, we can keep evolving it for that as well.
And I think that's a good point with our feature update strategy. You know, when we get to the next feature update, we'll of course have some improvements for the XF camera system, but now that we're looking at all the possibilities of this,
yeah.
You know, improving a feature, introducing a new feature, a new workflow with the IQ4 opens that possibility up to all these camera systems and really just elevates that whole open platform philosophy.
Whereas if you open, you know, a new feature on the XF, you can only use it with the XF camera.
Right.
And although we have a lot of XF users out there, some people, you know, are using technical cameras. So
right.
If we update this, not only are we adding that feature to the XF, but we're also adding it to technical cameras, to absolutely anything
yeah.
you're attaching
so
this back to.
It's win-win.
Exactly.
For the entire open
everybody's getting
philosophy.
An update.
And then just to wrap it up, we have, you know, full frame medium format, which is all of the IQ4s are based on full frame medium format. And we really think that's a fundamental sticking point that's very important to us.
Yeah.
That the crop sensors, anything larger than 35 but smaller than 645, is really not of any priority for us, because we want to be able to provide the most information, the best quality information, and that's all going to come from using these beautiful optics on the biggest sensor possible and really getting all the potential out of these camera systems. The Infinity platform we have, you know, updating the IQ4 progressively, and then of course we have all these possibilities with Capture One inside, so that your workflow out in the field and that WYSIWYG effect, that creativity at the touch of your fingers, is all going to be there, and we can expand on that and we can really grow that. We've really just scratched the surface of where we are with that.
Yeah, and I think that's the most interesting thing. Although we're stood here and can't say a bunch of things, we also know where we are in relativity to where this can go.
Right.
And I think that's the thing that we're most excited about, is how much we can actually add into this and what we can do. And as I said earlier, you know, I always say, can we do this? And you say, well, it's possible. We just need to allocate time and everything else to make it work.
If only there was 30 hours in a day, we'd get much farther, much faster.
Yep.
And I think, you know, that brings back why Peter's here and why it's so important for you, the viewers, to, you know, reach out to support and reach out to somebody like Peter. The majority of our technical supporters are photographers.
Yeah.
I think there's only very few that are very focused on some technical applications like cultural heritage and stuff like that that really aren't mainstream photographers. but the bulk of them are. And yeah. they use these camera systems. They love photography. They use all sorts of camera systems. And so they're going to understand what that workflow need is when you contact them and when you come to them with a Alpo, with a Cambo, with any camera system that you want a tighter integration with your IQ4. They're the ones that can really distill that knowledge down, hand it over to me in product management, and then we can figure out where it fits in our roadmap. So, Peter, before we go,
yep.
we're going to go over some of your images.
Okay.
So you have just put together a few different images. You have some time-lapse that you've done.
Yep.
we'll have you talk a little bit about that. You have some shots from Patagonia and Antarctica.
Yeah.
And you'll go over, you know, which camera system you used and how you used it and why those workflows were important to you at the time.
Yeah.
If it's, you know, space requirements, weight limits.
Yeah.
or anything like that. Now, your workflow, you're using the XF camera system as well as the Alpha TC. Those are your primary cameras.
Yeah.
So when you're traveling, you're bringing one digital back and then two cameras and then, what, three or four lenses?
Yeah. I try and travel as light as possible. So
I think everybody does.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
But it becomes difficult when you have the choice of everything.
That's true.
Sorry.
It's all right. You got a strong back. You're young.
Exactly.
But we can start by looking at, you know, some of your, these are collections of time-lapse that you've done
yep.
With the XF camera system. And the time-lapse tool exists on the XF camera system. You had like a ball head, like a, what's the one called?
The syrup.
Syrup ball head, so that you could actually pan the camera system. And I mean, that's just one use case that you have with all these tools in your backpack. So why don't you play one of these beautiful, this is Newhavn, tourist capital of Copenhagen.
So a lot of the places I traveled, I ended up traveling more than once to. So
yeah.
I thought this year I'd try and shoot some time-lapse instead of just the stills that I had already.
And this was probably shot on one of your more strenuous travel dates
yeah.
because you were actually in Denmark instead of
exactly.
all over the world. So
but I did cycle here, so it's harder than getting a cab. So
yeah,
actually, it was quite a strenuous walk.
Well earned.
Exactly. Okay, so yeah, this is just one of the time-lapses, obviously. Not edited in Capture One here, but again, you know, it is a use case for the XF.
Right.
You can shoot these super high quality time lapses, which you can jump in and get these huge details. You know, you can zoom, pan, move around like within the frame, even if you aren't moving.
And presumably, that one you had the ball head, the syrup ball head to actually pan, but you could have done this with a wide angle lens stationary.
Yep.
And then once you edited it, just panned within it.
Yeah, I mean, even cropping to like a 4K resolution, if you're shooting 150 megapixels,
right.
you've got so many options. You could take 10 different frames out of this time lapse.
Right.
And really punch in on details here as well.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, using the XF and the automated system, you know, that's one reason to have this fully integrated system.
Yeah.
But then when you're traveling, you're also packing pretty light with the Alpa TC.
Yeah, so hopefully, you know, as we said, in the future, we can do that with the
yeah.
with the digital back.
It's taking all these use cases and making sure that they're applicable to any camera system under that open platform philosophy that we have.
And again, having the different resolutions of file size and the different types of file size here as well can be really, really helpful. You know, I might not need the, you know, the extended, the huge
the 15 stops
here.
Of dynamic
yeah,
range.
Exactly.
And you could use the IQ4S, and that is going to be about 30 megs of resolution, 40 megs of resolution.
Yep.
And you can capture all those images. How many images was this captured?
This was, excellent question. This was around, I think, 600 images.
Right.
So start to end, and then obviously blended together afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously we're not blending the raw files, so I can work on the raw files beforehand. You know, still use Capture One almost as a grading tool for this. So
right.
I can edit in Capture One and then put them all together in another piece of, obviously, video editing software and get these kind of results out of this as well.
Yeah. And then let's go to some of your other ones. This is Patagonia.
Yeah, so this was actually shot on the Alpa TC.
Yeah.
I took this. We did 30 kilometers of hiking this day and 4,000 vertical meter climb.
Okay, so 4,000 meter vertical climb, 30 kilometers of hiking.
Yeah.
You kind of want to pack light.
Yeah. So as much as I, you know, love taking the XF and some of the extra tools that you get with shooting with that system, I think the Alpa was more suited here. I can take, you know, one or two lenses, save a little bit of weight here as well.
Just a touch.
Yeah.
Just a very small amount of
just
weight.
Just a small amount. And again, actually, when we got to the final spot, we couldn't see anything. The weather closed in so fast, and this was on the way back down. And we're walking back. I was kind of disappointed that I hadn't got anything, and it stopped raining for maybe
10 minutes out of the 9 hours we spent out that day. So I was having a great time. And again, touching back on the live view, this is where the, you know, where it was a real savior having that live view, actually exposure simulation, as everybody was annoyed. They wanted to get home. They wanted to get dry. And I'm there going, let's take some photos.
Right.
You can imagine how happy they were about this, but being able to set this up once, take the image,
right,
and
set it up quickly and use the electronic shutter. You didn't use an LCC with this image. Shame.
Sorry.
But with the BSI, you didn't really need it. I mean, there's really, I can see it the tiniest bit, but that's my discerning eye of where the lens cast is. But
and how much time I've put into actually correcting that lens cast. I mean,
which is
again my my editing is often pretty lazy in the way that, you know, I was always taught if you can't fix it in 30 seconds, it's not worth fixing.
You should have shot it correctly in the beginning.
Exactly. Yeah. So I probably should have shot it correctly, but again, if you're with a group of people, as we said, we've been out in the rain for 8 hours.
Right.
I didn't know if it was going to start raining again any second, so.
Yeah, but and that all comes down to, you know, being able to use the right tool for the right job. So you have the TC with you with the two lenses. It's much smaller. You have the IQ4 that's going to give you the same workflow and the same consistency. You know how live view works, so you set it up, get your exposure correctly. What you see in live view, click the shutter. That's what you get in the image.
Exactly.
And then below that, you have the unedited
image. Yeah, so we can just pull these up next to each other to start with.
And I think that's a much better example of, you know, did you really need an LCC?
Yeah, I mean, if you look up, you're often going to see this kind of in the corners here, and we can see up in the corner of our image, you know, yes, we do have a little bit of vignetting in the corner here, but it's not like, you know, it's reds and greens and purples and this other color cast. It's a very uniform, you know, color cast. It's very predictable as well. And the more I used it, the more I could be like, this is the kind of color cast I'm going to get instead of, am I going to get a red tone or, you know, what am I actually going to get in
But
this?
It's so insignificant that, you know, that's thanks to Capture One, you can just mask that up and adjust it. And, you know, going back to the trichromatic, where it's a front-side illuminated sensor, you're going to get beautiful color, but you are going to get that that lens cast that you're going to have to correct for, versus the IQ4 150 BSI sensor. We didn't use a, you didn't use, I'm not lumping myself in with that. You didn't use an LCC in this image, but if you zoom into that, hold on, shift. If you zoom into that sky, you know, this blue that you're getting from the edit and this blue that you actually captured, I mean, this is the raw captured blue.
Yeah.
And it has such a purity and such a high quality that you can push it to get that nice, deep, rich blue in Capture One without the color falling apart, without bringing up all this extra noise.
Yeah, and although, again, here I've, you know, exposed my highlights up in the top, and at the bottom, again, you know, it is a little bit on the dark side.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the quality and the way that we can pull up and having less noise on this, this was shot at actually at 80 ISO, so not even base ISO.
Right.
But we can see if we come in here, you know, you're not getting any noise buildup from pulling these shadows up here.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like it's, you know,
and you pulled it up like maybe a stop and a half.
Yeah.
And you've got plenty of room to go if you want to keep pulling that up.
I mean, the detail and the retention of, you know, not getting noise or not getting anything on
that image.
Yeah.
And then go up and just show some of the peaks of the mountain. Because I think, you know, what, when we talk about the IQ4 150, the one thing that, you know, we're I wouldn't say we're least proud of, but we have the least amount of attention is on the resolution, because we have so many possibilities to improve image quality and give you really stunning results. The high resolution, 151 megs of resolution, is a fringe benefit. It's great that we can get it, but that's not our focus. But when it comes to images like this, and you're gonna, this is a full scale image, you didn't crop in on any of that.
Nope.
So that can be printed one to one at like a meter by a meter and a half.
Yeah, and I think if you're shooting these huge landscapes and things like this, the ability to be able to blow them up that big without even enlarging the file, if I was to enlarge the file and actually do something with it, you know, we could print this, you know, the size of a building.
And, you know, that aside, if we just wanted to print this as a 16 by 20, you know, just a nice small image, we're really looking at the image quality, the depth of the image quality that you would only previously get with 4 by 5 or 8 by 10.
Yeah.
You know, when there's a contact print from an 8 by 10 negative, that detail is there, and I mean, it's really an immersive image that you can just explore for days. If we printed this as an 8x10 image, it would be the same thing. I mean, we can just explore this for days without ever worrying about detail, and I think that's part of the benefit that all that resolution provides us.
Yeah, and I think, you know, some of the cropping possibilities as well, you know, although this isn't the example, I did some down in Antarctica where, you know, we were with wildlife, obviously you can't get close to it for a certain reason.
Right.
You know, and having that extra reach of, oh, I can crop in a huge amount and still have something I can print at A1 or, you know, this huge size.
Right.
Even after making a crop, if you need to. I mean, in this position, I didn't have to, but it's nice to know the option is there.
And if we go to that next image that you have there, this is Patagonia again, or is that Antarctica?
Yeah, this is Patagonia again. This is actually shot on the XF this time.
Mm-hmm.
So this is on the 45mm on the XF.
Right.
I knew this day we actually climbed the glacier that you can see in the picture here.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought there'd be, you know, I don't want to set up my tripod on a glacier and sit and, you know,
right,
shoot. Or even carry my tripod on this day. Because again, we're climbing, we're doing other bits and pieces. So
right,
be able to take an XF and shoot handheld comfortably, you know, look through the viewfinder.
And this was at ISO 200 at a 500th of a second, so that's handheld territory for sure.
Yeah, so again, you know, we've got all this beautiful detail that we can look at up here, and that 45mm lens is just, you know,
tack sharp.
Beautifully, beautifully sharp.
And then when we just think about the, you know, the color quality, the image quality, the dynamic range, I mean, that's a very contrasty shot.
Yeah.
And if you don't have that dynamic range, you know, if you want to get all that detail, you are going to clip something out and you are going to have those details fall apart when you zoom in at 100%. But with all that dynamic range, with that amazing color, you know, you can zoom in and edit and move this around for days.
But I mean, if we look at this shot, there's been very little done to this shot. I mean, if I can push the right keys, we've come not very far at all in the way that, you know, you can see I've pulled out some nice highlight recovery there. And again, to have that option, again, we're moving through, it's kind of shot not completely on the fly, but it's not something I can sit around for hours and compose and get right and everything else like this. Having the ability to push that and to be able to get such rich colors out of this is really, really nice.
And this was shot with the 45, and you know, that 45 is technically like wide angle, but it's kind of right on the fringe of just being a standard lens. But if you wanted to shoot a panorama, you know, you would need the TC with a 23mm lens.
Yeah.
And if that's not an option, well, if you have the IQ4 150, you have all that resolution, well, you can shoot this with the 45, and then you can crop in and get that panoramic feel without you know, any of the distortion that a panoramic lens would give you.
And again, it's just opening up the options.
Yeah.
And again, this was a hiking day, and I really wanted to take the XF. The 45 isn't the lightest lens that we have. It is quite a monster, but it is worth, you know, I think the things like the 45 and the 35, you know, you might, I would say, I regret carrying it around all day until I use it.
Right.
And it makes it so worth it because I know the quality that I'm going to get out of that. And, you know, all I did was sacrifice taking the viewfinder. I took a waist level finder instead.
Cut down on some more weight.
Cut down on the weight there because I knew I wasn't shooting, you know, anything fast, like exceedingly fast paced. So again, I could use the waist level and the 45 to get this as well.
There wasn't any wildlife on the glacier face.
No. And this was, that was the only lens, only camera, only back I took that day. So I took the 45, attached to the XF, attached with the back and the waist level, and that was it. Didn't take anything else in my bag that day.
Not bad. All right, what else you got?
So we got some other bits and pieces, switching up lenses a little bit. When I went down to Antarctica, I shot a lot on the 240.
Mm-hmm.
This was something that I hadn't really shot with before. Being a landscape photographer, I never think to use the 240, which
is... That's bad.
I know. but again, because I'm shooting with the Alpha TC and I often go for weight, it's just something that I haven't really explored, which now I'm, after 2 years, I'm really kicking myself going, why haven't I used this lens more? Because I really, really fell in love with this lens while I was away.
And I think that, you know, just that little anecdote kind of brings up that if you're going to shoot to a wide angle, because we have that open platform philosophy, the IQ4 goes on an Alpha TC, and there's a lot of Rodenstock lenses that are beautiful wide angle lenses that are much, much smaller than integrated solutions wide angle lens. You know, smaller than the 45, the 35. Rodenstock is smaller and lighter. You get some less possibilities. It's manual focus. When you get into the telephoto lenses, you know, a Rodenstock lens that's going to be 180 mil is going to be a pretty big lens. The form factor is going to be slightly smaller than a 240. The weight will be lower than a 240. But when you're really breaking down the cost benefit of it, a TC with a very, very wide open, wide angle lens is going to be very small, very compact, very light. An XF with the 240 is going to be heavier, certainly, but that that lens is going to give you more integration that you're going to need at the telephoto focal lengths, like autofocus, for example.
Yeah.
So having that ability with the XF is kind of the trade-off, and that's when, you know, you're making those decisions.
Yeah, and again, here we're shooting from a boat, so I'm not going to be shooting with a technical camera from a boat.
There you go.
And yeah, this was approaching continental Antarctica for the first time.
Wow.
And I know, it's almost like you've been there as well. So we were approaching, and you know, I'm hanging over the side of the boat with the camera. I obviously didn't tell Drew this after I took one of the first prototypes, and I must admit, I did stop myself. It was quite a rough day. And I heard there's already phase one gear at the bottom of the sea somewhere.
Yeah, I did that.
So you know, I thought I'll wait. And I actually saw this shot. I saw these two little people standing at the bottom, and I really wanted to give it scale. So the 240, again, really compresses and gives this beautiful, you know, mountain range with the people in the foreground.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, by the time that I kind of got close enough or safe enough to take this shot without maybe dropping a prototype or an IQ4 into the sea,
right,
you know, some more people had actually started exploring.
Right.
So this is a bit of a cheat. I'm not going to lie here. I'm not going to tell you, oh, this is exactly how it was, because I did totally cheat here, but...
You were creative. I wouldn't say that you cheated. You used the tools that were available to you...
To recreate what
your
I
vision.
Saw.
There
exactly.
You go.
That sounded really nice. So as you can see, we've actually got quite a few people walking around here. And again, this is the sort of thing that, you know, some people might look at and go, oh, we need to put it into Photoshop or something else.
Mm.
And I can actually fully tell you, but this is all done in Capture One. I didn't use Photoshop at all here.
Yeah. And I mean, that's still the raw file that we're looking at.
Yeah. And again, you know, coming in to actually remove any of these people who were in the shot here,
mm-hmm.
you know, we've got, when this loads, we've got all this detail to work with. So actually cloning these people out and getting this shot was very, very easy in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I don't think I'm struggling for dynamic range in this shot. I've got the real white of the ice. We were some of the first people down there this year or last year. So there's not a load of muddy footprints and anything else like that.
Right. No penguins.
So, no penguins at this spot. So again, we have this, you know, because of the resolution, it actually has made it easier to get rid of these people and get the extra detail to do this.
And I think, you know, the use case again goes back to the right tool for the right job and having that open platform philosophy at your fingertips, because you're on a boat, you're moving, you're using a telephoto lens. So you can have autofocus. If you've programmed the XF to give you hyperfocal focus, that's something you can evoke and know in a moment that, you know, you can get that shot without taking your time, needing the boat to back up, which I'm sure they weren't going to do for you. But then, you know, you have this entire workflow that's kind of a closed loop in Capture One, where you can do these simple edits to give the image the exact look that you were hoping for. And it's all on the raw level, so you can always adjust it and move from there.
And these are things that I set up. You know, I did set up the hyperfocal. I did set up, you know, I made sure I trimmed all my lenses before I went. I did it in a way. So again, when I'm shooting over the side, not only do I have the preview on the back that I can trust from Capture One inside and everything else,
mm-hmm.
I also know it's going to be pin sharp without sitting and, you know, zooming in, double checking, everything like that. I can look at it and go, yep, next.
And that, you know, part of... The whole XF camera systems ecosystem is putting all those tools at the customer's fingertips so that you can program the camera and customize the camera to be exactly what it is you need.
And you just don't want to worry. You just want to think, okay, it's done.
Right.
Okay.
What else you got?
What else have we got? So we've got some other bits and pieces, again, depending on what I shot. Let's move away. We've done some with the 240. Let's have a look at some other, or a different example of the 240. So again, you were talking about panoramic and shooting panoramics. So I did shoot some panoramics in different ways. I also made some that I could crop,
right.
But I did shoot some panoramics straight away as well. So I did, one of these is done on the Alpa and the other one is done on the XF.
Okay.
And I think it's slightly different, but again, the workflow is very, very helpful in the way that we can do this.
Right.
So, this was the first one. This is the first image of a set of three that I took and then eventually stitched.
Right, that's with the Alpa.
So this is with the Alpa. We're on the 70mm lens here.
Mm-hmm.
So the
Rotostocks.
The longest lens that I took for the Alpa with me.
Right.
And again, we stopped to take this. It was exceedingly, crazily windy. I've actually sat on the floor taking this in fear of actually being blown away. And again, being able to have a tripod and keep myself down low here and kind of minimize the amount of size that it's going to blow against to stop it from wobbling in the wind. I then attached everything I possibly could to my tripod to keep it solid on the ground and make it as heavy as possible. And again, using stuff like the live view, using things like this, it means I'm not going to be sat around doing this. And as I go through my shots, I know I have enough overlap in each image because I can instantly flip into my live view. I can see, you know, where I'm working with here as well.
Yep. And of course, those workflow scenarios are what gives us a lot of ideas of where we can take this in the future without saying too much about making panos with the IQ4.
And again, you know, I probably could have shot this at a, you know, at a wider lens, shot it on the 35 and made the crop. Honestly, I didn't have the lens attached. We're again pushing for time, pushing to actually get our poor little van out of the mountains here.
And changing lenses in all of that wind is not exactly something that you look forward to doing. Yeah.
So again, you know, although these tools do have very specific uses, sometimes you have to just do the best possible thing you can at that moment. Mm-hmm. And this is where we got to with this as well. So that was shot with the Alpa. The next one, let's go to the central image. This is approaching the Fitzroy range, which is pretty iconic. A lot of people know what this looks like.
Right.
Again, crazy, crazy wind. If you've been to Patagonia, you know it is probably the windiest place I've ever been. And again, this is shot completely differently. This is shot in the 240.
Right.
And setting up things like the hyperfocal here was such a lifesaver because, again, so windy, you know, everything was moving. The camera is slightly bigger. You know, I'd taken the camera body out and I still had a strap on it from being on one of the boats.
Right.
So again, the strap's flapping around. You know, I'm trying to keep everything tied down, locked down so we can get this shot. And again, having the hyperfocal, I can just hit hyperfocal, you know, take some frames and really hold my tripod to the floor.
Right.
And here we're at 1/1000 of a second. And again, you know, being able to push the ISO up, you know, in a situation where it is super windy and know that I can still get the results.
Yeah, and I think that the use case of having an integrated camera system, you could have used something like the time lapse. So you could have told the camera system to take 5 shots, give me 3 seconds between each shot, and because you're concentrating on holding the camera, you push the button once, it goes to hyperfocal, you know that's your infinity focus, you move the camera, hold onto the tripod, it takes a shot, move the camera, hold onto the tripod.
Yep.
So it frees up your hands and, you know, all those tools give you the ability to do all this stuff with the XF camera system. And it's like what we talked about before, there's tons of options with the XF camera system, there's tons of options with the IQ4 on technical cameras. Knowing how to use what features and what tools at what time is really what makes this whole system powerful.
And sometimes, you know, it might not be the most conventional way. You know, most of the time you'd want to shoot a landscape, maybe not at 1/1000 of a second.
Right.
You might want to drop the ISO, but knowing that I can push it and be like, well, I need to be, you know, at a faster shutter speed. Or some of the other ones I took at things like sunset, where I had to handheld at sunset, knowing that I can push that and still recover the data from it.
Right.
Is, you know, it, again, it just opens up more possibilities. And I think every time we update or every time we add a new product, we just want to add more possibilities.
More tools that you can use.
Yeah, and more things that you can do with it, whether that be make different crops because of more resolution or push the files further or, you know, shoot at faster shutter speeds if needed without compromising image quality. I think a lot of those are very, very important.
Yeah. Excellent.
Cool.
Anything else, Peter?
We can go through one more if you want to do one more.
Let's do one more.
Let's do one more.
We're here, aren't we?
We are here. Let's do. Let's do this one. I probably should have brought more images with me, but let's do this one.
Penguins.
Penguins.
So again, another shot with the XF and the 240.
Yep. Again, as I said, it was something that I hadn't really used, and then it pretty much lived on the camera
on the XF.
And actually, while we were here, all of this we just couldn't see any of this mountain background.
Right.
While we're up there. So again, I thought I'd finish for the day. You know, my favorite shot of the day was this one beforehand.
Right.
And I'd taken this, and we're walking back and heading back, and I'd kind of, you know, powered off the camera. I'd called hands. I was pretty much done, wanted to get back and warm up. And as we came down, you know, these mountains started to clear in the background.
Right.
And again, having, as you said, the system where I can just boot it up, and you know how fast this all moves there.
Right.
You can see it from 4 or 5.
And it's reliability.
Yeah.
You know you can take it out of your bag, you can point it, you can take the shot, and you know that you have it.
Yeah. And I think it's that the pre-setup, as we've been through, you know, the tools that allow you to pre-set this up.
Right, so just preparing the system for what might come.
Exactly. And having something where I can just push a button, it's going to remember all the settings that I've already programmed, taking the time to make sure it's perfect. We're coming back down. These mountains revealed themselves for a very short amount of time, and I managed to get somewhat of a shot here that I can, again, I can crop in this massively if I want to take out the water in the front or anything else like this, and actually still have.
You can just do a portrait of a penguin.
Probably.
But I think if you were using just the Alpha TC with the 70mm lens, or even if you had a longer lens, and this happened, you would need the time to set up the tripod, to frame everything up, to get the shutter ready, and then hopefully
everything is still there.
Everything aligns and you can take the shot. Having the flexibility with the open platform philosophy of just taking the XF out, putting the IQ4 on it, pushing the button, it goes to the correct focusing distance. Your exposure, you can use the one-shot AE in the XF, so it automatically chooses the correct exposure for you, and then boom, you're done.
And as you keep saying, it's just consistency and knowing that you're going to be able to get that shot if something does reveal itself, you know, unexpectedly.
Yeah. All right.
Awesome.
Thanks, Peter. Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.
And thank you for joining us today. If you have any questions, just ask Peter at support.
Thanks.
that's what he's here for. So thank you for joining us. I hope we went over kind of the concept that we have here at Phase 1 about the open platform, making sure that the IQ4 can fit on all the camera systems possible, make sure that we can create a system, an ecosystem, a workflow that benefits really any challenges that are out there. And as always, your ideas, your wishes, we always welcome those, and we will fit them in with all the other ideas that come out of Peter's head, my head, and everybody else that works here at Phase 1, so we can really continue to grow the Infinity platform and the IQ4 and make this camera system even better, if that were at all possible.
If it were possible.
Thank you for joining us, Peter.
You're more than welcome.
We appreciate your insight and all of your beautiful images, and I think you have a plane to catch to China.
Probably.
Yeah, so thank you. And thank you. We'll see you next time.